Clarence Williams III. Well, welcome to the Jim Norton and Sam Roberts Show. A strange day. It's funny how people, when it comes to Louis, people have been asking for a long time. They're like, you're afraid to talk about it. You don't want to talk about it. Because until last night, by the way, I was invited to the premiere, and it was canceled.
Of course it was. That's the luck of Jim Norton.
That's when Jim Norton's involved with anything, bad things happen.
Well, part of it was you, and part of it was Louis C.K. masturbating in front of women in a hotel room.
Well, he did. I guess he knew that the article was coming. I didn't know what was happening. I just got a fucking...
Premiere or the masturbating?
The premiere.
Oh.
I just got with him, but someone's masturbating for me, I usually know it.
Oh, okay.
Because I've usually handed the money. But here's the allegations that I had heard. This is the rumor I had heard. Years ago, I had heard that he had done it jerked off in front of two women. That was a rumor years ago, but there was never a name on any of this. So you didn't know who it was. I don't know any of these people. And I'm not saying that they're lying at all. I don't know any of them.
Well, it's also, they didn't. The reason that this article is news is because there are names attached to it now. Like, of course, we had all heard the rumor, because I was getting that a lot too. Like, people were like, well, you knew about Louis C.K. I'm not going to say nobody, because obviously people did, the people it happened to, and Louis, and whoever, I guess, was told. But in terms of what I knew what any other person who reads blogs knew, which is, oh yeah, Louis C.K. is a creep, but like nobody ever mentioned a name. Everybody had every time you heard the story, it was kind of different. So there was no actual.
There was never a name. There was never a name to it. And I had heard about two women. I didn't hear that it was a comedy team. I had heard that it was two women, but I never heard it mentioned in a menacing. And this is years ago. It was never mentioned like in a menacing thing. Like, Judy, dude, it's so bad. So yeah, he jerked off. And then I was like, no, that's not true. Yeah, it's true. No, it's not true. And then Jen Kirkman's name got attached to it. I don't know how her name got attached to this whole thing. I have no idea.
I think she did some podcast where she said a comedian had jerked off in front of her. And it was heavily implied that it was Louis. Like, it really sounded like it was Louis, but then...
Didn't she change that, though?
Yeah, but then Jen Kirkman came out and said it wasn't Louis. Which, again, you know, who knows if she wanted to make it seem like it was, even though it wasn't. Who knows if later, you know, Louis's manager got to her and she was like, just go out and say it wasn't him. And, you know, it could have still been Louis.
See, Louis doesn't respond to stuff like this, although on this one he may have to. This is a very big story. I mean, it's front page of the papers. You can't not... respond to it.
I mean, you could not. You could just.
I guess you could not. Yeah, maybe you can
just
not.
Go away for a while.
Yeah, but it's difficult. But look, man, if you're doing that to women at work, did he know that they didn't want him to do that? Because it's like you kind of hope it's not true. It's like, I love Louis. He's one of my favorite people.
I mean, nobody.
But you can't.
Nobody.
I don't think five separate people are lying. I don't think these women are lying.
I don't think any of them are lying. And I mean, it's one thing if you're propositioning somebody that you are in a relationship with, or you're speaking sexually to, or like, you know, you're in that scenario, but just a woman at work and being like, hey, can I masturbate in front of you? Like, there aren't any women who would want that question asked of them.
That's a bizarre thing. Like that, I don't understand that. I don't understand saying to a woman, like, can I jerk off in front of you?
I don't understand any, like, the whole thing. And I don't think that the stuff that Louis did is nearly as bad as what Harvey Weinstein or Kevin Spacey did at all.
Well, hold on. With Louis, though, isn't it like, didn't he ask all the women? I'm not saying what he did was right. It's creepy at work.
Right. So it's not rape, but he didn't rape anybody. But part of the problem is that he was asking women in inappropriate scenarios. And the story that the comedy team told, that Louis jerked off in front of, that they say he jerked off in front of them in the hotel, which I believe them, is that they were at this Aspen Festival,
yep,
and they had performed and the bar was closed and Louis was like, oh, let's go up to my room and get drinks. And the article, and I believe it, made it seem like this wasn't a, hey girls, you want to come up to my room? It was, hey, let's just hang out. We're all comedians. There's two of you. We're friends.
Now, does he, and again, he may have known that. It may have been a friendly vibe that maybe he just made really creepy. Or did he think, hey, these two girls are coming up to my room? I have no frame of reference in front of two women who are friends to take off all your clothes and just jerk off. I can't wrap my head around that. I can't wrap my head around doing that. Like, do you know that they don't want you to do it? Or do you think, because they said, the girl said that they were, it was awkward and they were kind of like screaming and laughing. Did they make it look like they were like, oh God, look what he's doing. It's crazy. It's fun. Or did they let it be known that they weren't enjoying it?
No, they didn't. They ran out after it said in the article.
But did they let him know while it was happening that they weren't enjoying it?
They were laughing while it was happening because it was so uncomfortable for them.
Yeah, maybe did he read that wrong? Or did he not care?
No, I don't think
it's, or did he not care that it was uncomfortable?
I don't think that he read the situation wrong.
You'd
I think
be surprised,
that,
dude, you would be surprised that people do read it. I'm not defending what he did. It's creepy. But you do read situations wrong all the time. People read it all the time. They read situations wrong.
Once you got your dick out and you're naked, you know, you have to take some responsibility. It's tough to read a situation.
Well, yeah, of course. I'm just saying you can read situations wrong.
Especially if you're drinking.
Yeah, it's not saying that it's not it's the right thing to do.
Yeah.
But I want to know, what is the mindset when you go up there? Do you know that you're making two women uncomfortable jerking off in front of them? Like, I can't wrap my head around doing that.
It's probably the same mindset of people who jerk off on the subway.
No, yeah, maybe it is. Although people on the subway tend to be crazy. They tend to be homeless and crazy. Not yeah. all of them. But they don't tend to be rational thinkers either.
It is weird to hear this from a rational thinker.
And they don't tend to do it in front of people they know. And they don't tend to do it in front of coworkers. People on the subway are randomly doing it, and it's almost an act of aggression. Is that what it was from him? Maybe.
But there are people who do it in public and on the subway and stuff like that aren't necessarily crazy homeless people that are that exhibitionist thing. And, you know, a lot of women have stories. I've told Jess a story before where the thing that takes them out of it is when a woman says, I don't like this. And then they kind of just like stop. The guys who like rub, and then the woman turns around and says, knock it off. And then they stop. It's almost like this fantasy that's built up in their head where they like this. They won't say anything, but they like this. They like this. And until somebody says, hey, stop it, I don't like that, that's what jars them out of this weird mental fantasy that they're in.
Well, that's kind of what I'm saying. Did he have that weird thing, even though he's a genius comedian, did he have that weird thing where he's thinking like, oh, they're fucking into this. They think this is hot to see me doing this. They like the naughtiness of this. Like when you're an exhibitionist,
yeah.
What is it? Like for me, you know, sex is shameful.
Right.
So I don't want people watching. You know, it's got to be, there's a weird thing I like that turns me on that is obviously not the same as this. This doesn't turn me on. The idea of jerking off in front of somebody in an office doesn't turn me on because it's like, it's just too uncomfortable.
Right.
But when you're an exhibitionist and that's your thing, do you convince yourself that the other person is fucking loving your dick and go, oh my God, this is so fucking hot. So that's what I'm saying. Are you reading these things? Are you reading an innocent moment wrong? Or do you know it's uncomfortable and not give a shit?
Well, I think that it's nuanced a little bit. Like, I don't, to say that you're reading it wrong is to almost put a little too much innocence on it. Like, there's some crazy to it.
There might be some crazy to it, yeah.
Like, and I think that you're not reading it wrong in the sense that, like, you or I are just like, oh, I didn't realize that person was mad at me or whatever. Like you or I could read something wrong, but still be in touch with reality. I think that, like, when you get to doing stuff like this, that's so, I think that's why you and I can't relate to it, is because there's a bit of crazy to it where in his head, it's very possible that he wasn't sitting here and being like, I'm victimizing them. They like this. But anybody that can pick up on signals would know these are uncomfortable people.
Because it's strange, like, he would ask.
Right.
Like, they said he would ask. It was like, you know, somebody said to me last night, look, you respected no means no. Like, yeah, at work, though, it's creepy at work, man. You just can't do it. Like, someone's going to work, they're doing a gig.
Yeah.
You just can't do it. I mean,
no.
It's
like something you, it's creepy to just do it at a bar if you haven't built to it. You know what
if
I mean?
If you haven't built to it, it's definitely creepy.
Even socially, it's something that you build to. To just masturbate in front of a person is not a terrible thing to do if you've built up some rapport. You
right.
know what I mean? Like you get there. You probably should have kissed already.
See,
right?
No, not necessarily.
Or something. You know what I mean, though? Like, there's a sexuality to what's going on. Like, you are hooking up tonight.
Yeah, and do you delude yourself? Like, what causes you to go down that thought? And again, I'm a dirty guy. Like, I'm a perverted guy.
Right.
But this is one I don't get. Like, there's certain elements of sexuality I don't get. And, being with people who, like, are at work, Like, I guess because I'm so fucking panic-stricken at work and I'm always afraid of getting fired that I just have, I can't be sexual.
It's so weird.
How do you do it in an office?
It's so weird what sex does to people. I can't understand it. Like, I can't understand the people who, any of these guys, like, who throw everything away because they're so obsessed with this thing. I mean, not, again, I'm not comparing Louis C.K. to kid touchers, but a kid toucher who, like, knows, I'm going to go to jail forever. I'm going to get raped in jail if I do this.
But it overpowers
but
you.
But I can't. I got to keep doing it. Or, you know, Harvey Weinstein. I know this is wrong. Of course this is wrong. But I'm Harvey Weinstein. I need this power. I need to get this high. It's like, I guess it's like a drug addict who's like, I understand. I'm putting this needle of heroin in my arm. The only thing this leads to is death. There's nothing besides death that this leads
to. But the urge or the lust or whatever overpowers your brain. But the thing is, like, the woman on the phone, like, dude, I think two of them said what he did was on the phone. Like, he was just, they think he was jacking off on the phone. Like, all right, that's creepy, but it's not, that's not work. Like, because you could just hang up on somebody if they're jerking off on the phone. Just fucking hang up on them. The problem is when you're doing it and you're working for HBO or for Chris Rock and you're jerking off in front of someone who's kind of new there, like, that's a problem. Yeah. And it's bad.
Although if you, I don't know. I think if you call a woman that you're working with.
Were they working together, the woman he's talking about?
They were some kind of work peers. You know,
he knew her ex-boyfriend or something.
Yeah. I mean, either way, you've heard.
It ain't right. Right. It ain't right to call someone and jerk off on the phone, but it's not New York Times worthy. If that's the only thing, you hang up on a person if they're doing that.
It's like Page Six worthy.
Yeah, it's creepy on a certain level, but it's not like in the age of there are rapists and pedophiles, that doesn't merit. But the other stuff.
But that coupled with the other stuff.
Absolutely, yeah. And apparently, and you can't say it's not true because, and I love Louis. He's one of my favorite people in the world, but the reality is, if David and Patricia Arquette are saying, yeah, they came to us in 2003, if there's apology emails, then there's absolutely, there's some truth to it, if not all truth to it.
And I mean, honestly, knowing Louis, if it were not true, he probably would not cancel everything.
Yeah, I got
He would probably get in front of it.
Do you know how I found out that there was a Times article coming out?
Louis told you, you knew the whole time.
Yeah, and he gave me all the names.
He gave you everything. He bragged about it with you.
No, Louis is a strange guy, and I say that lovingly. He's a guy who will talk to you, but someone's asking, did Louis talk to me about this? No. It's not the way he does things. Like, he'll text you about stuff. He texted me recently, just went, hey, man, I was thinking of you. How are you? And we're just chatting back and forth. And then he just stops texting. Like, he's just gone. He just disappears. Like, he's just, and Bob Kelly and I have talked about that before. Like, one day you're talking to him and, hey, man, how are you? Okay, let's get together. And then you don't talk to him for 8 months.
You're best friends, and then he disappears.
Yeah, so, no, he never actually spoke to me about these. But I was coming home yesterday. And I knew I had this premiere last night. I was going to do Chip and then go to the premiere.
You thought you had this premiere.
Of that, I did.
Yeah.
And I got a text from my publicist who said that due to unforeseen circumstances, she sent me the email that they had sent out. And then I got the email. So I'm like, huh, all right, maybe, who knows, maybe he just didn't want to do it. And then I got a text from Don Lemon. Don Lemon and I've never met Don Lemon, but I do love him because he and I have been texting for over a year.
How'd you start texting?
Was it over furniture or financing? We have a mutual friend. I don't even remember how he connected. It was something. He was going to help me find someone to do construction for the apartment well over a year ago.
Mm-hmm.
And they said Don Lemon had some work. We knew a mutual person, so we texted, and we literally have just not been able to get together for a year and a half. So I'll once in a while randomly text Don Lemon, hey, how are you? Or he'll text. It's very bizarre. But I got a text from him. He goes, hey, man, what's up? And he sent me a link to the article. And I told him, truthfully, this is the first time I'm hearing that there's an article. And I didn't read it until, I guess, when it came out.
Yeah, I had heard in the afternoon yesterday, that's when the premiere got canceled and everybody was saying, and he was trending, and the details weren't out, but they were like, there's a New York Times article coming. And then I think at 3 o'clock, 2 or 3 o'clock in the afternoon, the Times just put the article out.
Yeah. Obviously, he knew it was coming. They said he's not commenting. And I don't know what the right thing to do here. Like, if you're him, should you? Like, I would personally love to hear him talk about it. Just, like, what's right and what's wrong? What was your mentality? Like, did you go, like, look, I'm fucked up and I like to do this. And I sensed that they were uncomfortable, but I just had to come or I didn't care. Or did you convince yourself, like, I thought they loved it? And I'm crazy to think that they loved it. Like, I don't understand the mentality.
I'm definitely curious about it. Like, I'd love to hear about it just for our benefit. But I think you know, the best thing Louis can do for himself
is probably not sure.
Yeah, just lay low for a while and then wait until this blows over, wait until more accusations come out about more people, because it's going to happen.
And Spacey, the difference between this and Spacey coming out and saying something is that Spacey was covering an act with an underage person.
Maybe multiple.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But I mean, the original one was like an underage person. Someone said he tried to touch me when I was a child, and then he went, I'm gay. And then gay people like, nah, fuck you. Don't lump us in with that.
Although it would have been really funny if Louis just sent out a tweet that said, by the way, I'm gay.
Yes. Yeah, that would be. Yeah. But
yeah, I was really bummed out, to tell you the truth, when I heard it. Because like, I've only known Louis to be a pretty good guy. He's done a couple things off the air to me that like made me think like this is a really good dude.
Yeah,
he's done things that like a person in his position didn't have to do. And I did, I mean, it made me think. I read the article and I have had one phone conversation with him. I do not think he was masturbating, though.
Probably not.
I'm almost positive.
Unless there was news that you were in the hospital sick, and all of us would have. Yeah,
it's just circle jerking.
But yeah, man, it's weird. It's weird when it's a friend of yours, because I love him. He's, you know, again, I've known him for 20 years, and he's a guy that I love. And it's like, here's what I hope. I hope that he addresses it at least, and I hope that I feel bad for the people it happened to. And I'm not saying that just because you're supposed to say it. I really do. It's got to be uncomfortable if there's somebody you admire and they, you know, like it's a work situation. Yeah. You're like, wow, I love this guy. Oh no, it's that.
And then.
And you're not into it.
Yeah, you go, oh no, exactly. Yeah, you go, oh no, it's that. And then you sit there and you watch him become like the most beloved person in comedy. And you almost are like, what about this thing? Like, this thing happened. Yeah. Like, this really happened.
But for people that were always asking about the rumors and stuff like that, that was what I heard years ago. I never heard names to it. And I tell you, in complete honesty, I don't know any of the people who are involved. And if I've met them, I don't. So it was like never like, oh, did you hear what happened to Sarah or to this girl? It was just this rumor. And you know, I'm not stupid. Chances are where there's smoke, there's some kind of fire. But there was never a name attached to it. I'm like, why would anybody be scared? I guess I'm not a woman. I don't have that fear. But apparently it's like a lot of them said that someone tried to silence them. They said that his management tried to silence them or spoke to them, or they were told to talk about it. Yeah, of course.
I could totally see where somebody would not talk about it.
But it's hard. It's weird when you, like, I have no frame of reference for that. Like, to me, it's not scary to, if someone does something, to mention it. But I guess when you're a woman and you're in the business and someone does shit like that, it's scary. And, you know, I know somebody recently, something happened to. It's sexual. It's disconnected. It's not as serious as this, but
Louis did it, though?
He did not do it.
No. Okay.
And she didn't want to talk about it. And she told me about it, and she didn't know what she should do publicly. And the reasons she didn't talk about it that are not, but it's like the fear of backlash, or of people saying something. And I told him, like, but you didn't do anything wrong. Like,
there is also this thing, though. I mean, and you probably wouldn't feel it just because everything about your sex life has been so public. But like, when people come out and they say this thing, this traumatizing thing happened to them, whether it's, you know, stuff like the women in this story or the Kevin Spacey story with the dudes or whatever it is, like, a stigma does get attached to them. Even though they're victims of this thing, there is this sexual victim stigma that gets attached to them. And especially before now, when it was just this big thing, when it wasn't quite as big, you become crazy Corey Feldman, who's, you know, kind of a joke, or you become crazy Rose McGowan, or whoever it is. You look at these people that did kind of step forward before all this was going on, and they did have a stigma attached to them.
I just don't, I can't understand. Like, I guess when something sexual happens, you have to, okay, do I understand the desire to do this? Like, and to be nude in front of somebody who's not like 100% down with it.
Right.
And I'm not saying like I'm this great guy at all. It's just literally, it's what turns me on. Like, there's certain things, your turn ons are your turn on, you know. You like what you like, and the idea of someone going,
yeah, right.
Like, I'm like, oh no. Like, that kind of, you know, I like somebody's dirt. Like, I like the icon. I like somebody who's filthy.
Right.
And who fucking, so I'm saying is, can you delude yourself into thinking that person is filthy and giving you that when they're not? Maybe you can. But I would love to hear from him on, did you know that they were uncomfortable? That's a big part. Doing it at work, though, the reason it's a problem is because when you're on a set, you can't say to somebody, even if they want you to, you can't say to somebody, do you want to watch me jerk off?
Of course not.
You just can't.
No.
You know.
And you wonder, though.
If a woman said, I'd love to watch you jerk off, I'd be down.
She could come up to you and suggest it. You wonder, though, like maybe it's one of those things where you dilute yourself in the moment. And then after it happens, you're like, that's when the shame kicks in. You're like, maybe. Obviously they didn't want that. That was stupid. Why did I do that?
But I had a thing with a girl one time on a set, a good thing. When we flirted and we did blah, 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 we got to know each other. But it was such a slow, scary, like we never even had sex. But it was one of those things where you think you're getting a little bit of an energy. And then you're like, am I deluding myself? Like, and then you talk a little bit, and then we'll go out, we'll have some food, and it's such a fucking slow process. But again, it's because I'm paranoid of getting in trouble. Yeah. You don't want to do anything that's going to get you fucked at a network.
And mentally, there is something off about going from, is there a little energy here? I guess I should jerk off in front of them. Like, that's going from step 1 to 15.
Exhibitionism is just one for me. I just never did. I'm much more of a voyeur. And because I've had girls say things like, oh, I love to fuck in public, and I'll talk. I'm like, yeah. No, I don't. Forget it. My fucking dick would wilt like you hit with a hammer.
It would.
I just couldn't do it. The risk of getting caught. Like, that's a big one for people. And I'll talk dirty to you about it. I'll text dirty about anything. But the reality of it is, the risk of getting caught in public, fucking forget it.
Do you think that as a comic, the fact that, like, you go back now, and you look at a lot of Louis' work in a different context, and some of it's fair and some of it's not fair, but the fact that there was so much material about jerking off, the fact that there's this thing, did you see the video from Louis of him going on
Fox?
Yeah, the fake Fox.
I saw
Fox
the clip, and, yeah. But no, I never...
Like, do you think that was partly... Or like the Pamela Adlon scene where he's kind of like pushing himself on her, which has now been out there a lot. Like, do you think that some of this stuff...
Is there truth in art?
Is there a cry? But is it almost like a cry for help? Like, I wish I could just tell you this is what I need you to know about me.
I don't know about a cry for help. Like, I sometimes you tell your dirty secrets through your work. Other times you're talking about things that, like, oh, thank God that ain't me through your work. Other times you're just taking a normal thing and exaggerating it. Like, it really does.
But without it, because he never acknowledged, like, this is something that I actually like. So, like, but do you think that there is part of a therapeutic thing where, like, if I just can inject this into my work without saying it, it'll get it off my chest?
Maybe, yeah. Maybe it's your way of confessing it or talking about it. I don't know. I honestly don't know. Because my, for me, I've just kind of come out and said stuff.
You're more of a literal guy.
Yeah, yeah. But I kind of know what I like at this point, and I know what doesn't turn me on and what does turn me on. And, let's see here. A lot of, John in New Jersey is talking about the New York Times article. What's up, John? How you doing,
buddy? John in New Jersey.
What exit? Hey, I'm being cute,
hey,
John.
What's up, guys?
Hey, man. What's up?
Hey, so I really have a problem with the New York Times article, and obviously I'm a big Louis fan, but the way I look at it is there are really four incidents that they're reporting on, and I really think that only one of those incidents is arguably problematic, and that's the one in the hotel room with the two women where he just gets naked and starts masturbating. The other, you have the woman on the phone, which I agree with you 100%, Jimmy, just hang up the fucking phone if a guy starts jerking off. Then you have the other girl at the Chris Rock show who, from my understanding of the article, agreed to have him do it on more than one occasion. And what the article says now is that she regrets it now. And so if a woman that regrets a sexual encounter that happened like 10 years ago is the basis for assault, then we're all in trouble.
I'll tell you one thing. They said Louis C.K. is accused by five women of sexual misconduct. In fairness to the Times, they are not accusing him of assault. They are acknowledging that he did get some kind of permission in his own head to do it.
They're not saying he apologized.
He's not a monster. I think he just has a shit judgment, and I think he just probably read these people fucking wrong, unless there's other things. The problem with the Chris Rock one, though, is if you're way above somebody on the ladder in show business and you ask them, you have to understand their answer may be tainted with a desire to please you because you're at HBO and you're working for Chris Rock. And you understand what I mean? Like, you kind of have to. And the phone ones are different to me, much different.
I think that
because
the phone ones,
you can't prove them, and you can also just go, like, just hang up the fucking phone or just say you got to go.
I think that, what you're saying. The phone ones are not as serious, but at the same time, like, when you start saying just hang up the phone, like, that's a slippery slope into victim blaming.
No, like, no, it's not. No, 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 no. The victim blaming is saying, like with Kevin Spacey, he's grabbing a reporter's dick under the table. How about just going, don't do that?
Yeah, but it is problematic if you have a guy, if Louis's thing is he likes to call women and he's masturbating on the other end of the phone. Like, that's a problem. It's not sexual assault and it's not the same thing as masturbating in front of women, but it is not a healthy thing. It is a problem if a big star is calling women and masturbating on the other end of the phone.
Yeah, but it's not level. I mean, what's been exposed with people, again, Harvey Weinstein maybe brought up in rape charges, Kevin Spacey touching underage people. It doesn't belong in the same conversation, hey, a guy jerked off on the phone. Mm-hmm. In the context of other stuff, yeah, I get why they put it in.
Right.
But I do think with that one, and I'm not victim blaming, I'm not saying those fucking bitches were talking sexy to him. I'm just saying if you're uncomfortable with the way someone's being on the phone, get off the phone. If he was yelling at you, you'd get off the fucking phone. But to me, the HBO one is a problem as well, dude. It's not just the one, not just the hotel room, because you're at work, even though she gave her consent, it's like you're at work. And if you're above someone on the totem pole, like if you're a fucking intern and you ask the executive producer if you can jerk off in front of her and she says yes, that's different.
That's terrific.
Because she's the boss. Yeah. And you've got a great game. But if you're above someone on the totem pole and they're young and eager to work there, you got to understand their yes may be tainted with uncomfortable.
That's, yeah, I agree
it's
with
just
that.
Bad, really shitty judgment. Yes, John, I'm sorry.
It's more, I hear what you're saying in that work dynamic, but it was more than one yes. And so, and what she's saying now, yes, and what the New York Times article reports, is just that she regrets it. And like, so to me, it sounds like she was okay with it at the time, regardless of what the power dynamic was. And now she's saying she regrets it. And like, I just don't think that that's newsworthy either, because she's coming forward with something that she agreed to, and okay, she regrets it 10 years later. I mean, why is that in the time?
Well, because it was a work incident. Because it was a work incident, John, I think that's why.
And there's also, like, there's all contracts have something called, like, you're
moral
signing
clauses or whatever,
and you're signing under duress. Like, if you're saying yes multiple times, but you're saying yes under duress because of the situation that you just brought up, Jim, it's not the same as just being like, yeah, this sounds great, and then 5 years later being like, I wish I hadn't done that. It's different than just being like, oh yeah, no, I really liked it at the time, but now I regret it. I don't think that's what she's saying.
Or is it a case of, hey, look, they were flirting? And again, is it one of those things where, yeah, maybe she did give him sexual vibes, and maybe she did indicate, yeah, this is kind of hot to me and naughty and turns me on. I'm a bit of a voyeur. Maybe it did. And then she regrets, like, fuck, man, I was at work and that wasn't what I wanted to do. So the problem is not even the fact that she was saying yes. It's the fact that at work, you just can't do it.
Yeah.
You can't, when you're writing for HBO, do that.
Yeah.
Because again, it's even if the person is 100% down with it, you gotta, like, what you're at work, and is that can be a problem. Like, you gotta think, and again, that's, again, it's 12 years ago, slightly different then than it is now. But I just know how fucking paranoid I am around here. Like, fucking, it terrifies me flirting with anybody here. Hello, how are you? Hello, God bless, hello. All right, John, I appreciate the call. Thanks a lot.
Yes. All right, thanks. Bye.
You'd rather have a reputation for being rude than for flirting, right?
Yeah, and I do get how you can, like, hey, man, if they had an energy going back and forth and he thought she liked it and she consented to it, yeah, I get that that's not any type of an assault. It's just shitty judgment. But it's also the problem you have is this wasn't on your couch. If this was on your couch, I wouldn't even be talking about it. If they went out a few times and had dinner and he goes, I want to go home and jerk off, and she's like, I'd love to come watch you, this was not even part of the conversation.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's just two adults. One may regret it later, but hey, if you're going to regret it later, you shouldn't have said yes in the moment. You should avoid it. But at work, you know, it's someone in the business below you on the totem pole.
Yeah, you can't. You just can't.
Yeah. When will comedians start to defend other comedians? Mike and hi, Mike. What are you talking about?
Hey, I'm really disappointed what I'm listening to this morning. And here's why I say this. You know, I mean, we already got this guy already guilty until proven innocent. You know, just like the other caller said, this happened years ago. This is a problem I have not right now, is that not people coming out because they get their 5 minutes of fame. They go out there, this hurt me 10 years ago. Now you wanted this poor guy's fucking career.
One thing at a time. We're all talking to you. Look, Louis is one of my favorite people. I'm not attacking Louis. I love the guy.
I know that.
But the reality is, I didn't speculate on the rumors because I really didn't have a name attached to it. And I'm like, I'm not going to fucking say shit about a guy who I love when there's zero substantiation. But now if there is, and these people are saying, yeah, this is what happened. It's got to be talked about. And what is there to defend? He's not a rapist. He didn't force anybody physically to do anything. But is it inappropriate and shitty to do? Yes. So it's like, what kind of defense do you want? I'm not sure but what you'd want people to say. I'm not saying he's 100% guilty. I'm saying I'd love to hear his rebuttal to this. He may have a totally different story.
If he's canceling all of his stuff, if he's canceling his premieres and he's canceling his press because this article's coming out, I think that that kind of speaks volumes in and of itself.
Maybe. Not always, though. Sometimes people do cancel shit because they don't want it to taint the thing. Or like, what? Or Colbert may have canceled him. Colbert may have said, look,
he
this is coming
other
out.
Press that's not.
But yeah, I don't know if that's telling
you. It's getting too easy. And here's why I'm going to tell you this. Okay. You know how easy this could be, Jim? You're my favorite.
Thank you.
That's everybody knows. You're my favorite comedian of all time. I could bring my wife to your next show, have my wife have a big fawn on her with a scared look, and take a picture. Somebody take a picture of me, you, and my wife. I'll wait 3 months later and says, hey, after one of his shows, we went out to eat. We talked about his career and everything. I went to the bathroom. All of a sudden, Jim took his dick out and started showing my wife his fucking huge cock.
Thank you for the adjective. Yeah. I would probably say here's how you know he's lying, then show my dick.
Yeah, but
Mike, hang on, Jim.
With all seriousness, I worry about you guys because they get to a point now you can't even make a joke no more. The political correctness and everything else. All right, Harvey Weinstein is one fucking thing. But, you know, I mean, the comedians are the most important thing, and everybody's, especially Trump,
I think you're right. Mike, you don't want to muddy the water. This is what happens, though. Like, you make a joke, and they say, yeah, making a joke is the... And that's one thing. You defend your joke, or you can fucking argue with the feminists who hate your joke or whatever. But it is different than, okay, this is what happened. If women are coming out and saying this is what happened... then it's got to be addressed. And look, if he can address it someday, and I'm sure he will in his own way, the good thing for him is this. He didn't apparently force anybody to do anything. And apparently he called a couple of them and tried to apologize and said, look, I was in a really dark time in my life.
He sent a Facebook message and apologized.
And this is all over a decade ago when I'm guessing he was going through some kind of a marriage crisis. Not an excuse.
See, but that's
Mike,
my point,
hang on.
Jim. Let me make sure. You're pretty smart. Okay, go ahead.
What do you really think... That people accusing other people of sexual misconduct and sexual harassment and sexual assault is a bigger problem than
Sam,
the idea.
Can I answer that?
Yeah, let him ask you, Mike. Let Sammy ask you a question.
Do you think that that's a bigger problem than the fact that there's sexual misconduct and harassment and assault that's happening like crazy, and this is just everybody finally getting called out for it? Don't you think that the actual acts that are happening are far worse than the idea that people are calling people out for it?
Well, let me tell you this. Here's my answer to that, okay? I don't know if it is. You don't know if it is.
Oh,
like
God.
Jim said, it could be a mutual understanding at that point, okay? Not because somebody wants 5 minutes of fame. Look, here's the deal.
You're not getting famous.
If they had a problem, either that day or the next fucking day, say something about
they
it.
Did.
Not fucking 10 years later.
They did say something, Mike. They
I'm
did say something,
your
Mike.
Career.
Mike.
I'm about
they said
career.
Something the next day.
I'm about,
Mike.
I'm
they said
about
something.
Mike, you don't have to worry about it.
They said something the next day.
They did say something.
They were silenced by his manager. It says it in the article. You don't have to worry about us because we're honest about what we're doing. I don't have any.
Well, I know that.
Like, there's zero skeletons that'll come out, and very few that'll come out for Jim.
Yeah, there's one that everybody knows.
No, Club Soda. You don't even have Club Soda Kenny no more. I'd like to offer my services for you.
No, I still have Kenny, dude. He's
270.
All right, well, thank you.
I have to fuck people up.
All right, buddy. Okay. All right, thank you very much, Mike. You're a good egg. Thanks for the call, buddy. I appreciate it. No, that is one thing is on the road. I did always have Kenny, which, you know, Kenny spent a lot of time with me and whoever I was with, but yeah, again, I don't.
You mean it's just like almost like see nothing's going on here type thing.
But that's not why I had him. He was a great travel companion. It's only on this last tour that like, from the middle of the last tour on. But he doesn't come with me now because I just don't really need it. Like he can do everything from home.
Yeah.
I'm not selling merch. I was getting shit for somebody, but anyway, who cares? Let's see here, Luke in Sacramento. Yes, Luke.
Yo.
Hey, buddy.
Jim.
Yes, sir.
See, why didn't you do what why don't these female comics do what you did, is when Louis C.K. whipped his dick out and started jerking off, you just suck it.
You said dicked, Luke. You said his dicked out. Pulled his dicked out. So, Luke,
sorry, wrong tense.
Luke, you panicked. Fucking panicked.
I did.
All right, thank you, Luke. Luke just fell apart there. He fucking totally panicked.
He did.
Pulled his dick out and you sucked it. Fucking boo, Luke.
He was thinking of sucked, but he was still on dick.
I know.
And
Luke.
Oh, Lou.
Let's see. I understand this too as, yes, Avery in Tennessee.
Yes.
Hello.
As a woman that works around a lot of men, and have been put in situations my whole life, I don't understand why some of these women just don't leave.
I don't understand it either, but I've never been in that position. But you've been in that. What have you been in that position? What's happened?
Well, I mean, there's always been creepy guys, and so, you know, somebody goes to do something. Now, putting children and rape aside, just simply talking about, you know, people that were like in that situation. I mean, I would just be like, oh my God, that's disgusting, and leave.
Well, I think that there are a couple things. Number one, a lot of people go into shock. Number two, in a lot of these situations, they're people that want to have and need to have a professional relationship, a good relationship
with
the person who's doing it. So they go like, you know, as the moment's happening, they kind of go into shock. They go, oh my God, I can't believe this is happening. I didn't think this would happen, but I also want this person to like me, and should I just stay? And you know, as you're processing this, it's like a traumatic thing happening.
But does that ambiguity, does that kind of vagueness in reaction tell the person, and again, because he's not forcing anybody to do anything, does that tell him in his mind, like, especially when there's two women, like when there's two women, is if they're watching and giggling and being, however they were being, maybe they were being very sullen and miserable too, I don't know. But does that tell you in your mind, yeah, this is consent, this is what they like? Are you convincing yourself that that's what they like? I don't know.
I can tell you, though, that there are certain situations I just wouldn't put myself in. Again, I'm not talking about anybody who was raped or any children, but just like these two women. You know, a guy asks you up to his room. He may or may not have been drinking. Stupid stuff starts happening. The minute the guy walks out naked, I'm hardly, as a grown woman, in shock. I'm just like, creep, and I leave.
Unless they're comedians that think it's a joke.
Or if you're young comedians, right, and you think like, in 2005, Louis was not what he is today. People are saying he was wielding, he had some power, he was a head writer, but he was not the
when
Louis.
When did Lucky Louis come out?
2006, I think. 2005, okay, if this happened, or 2004.
But this was after his time on Conan, correct?
Yeah, yeah. He definitely had power in the business, but he wasn't the Louis that people know now.
He's not giving people shows.
No. He was not that kind. But if you're too young, eager, I could see why somebody would go up to the room. It's weird in show business, quote unquote, because a lot of times when you know somebody and they're fairly famous, you for some reason suspend normal thought process. You suspend your normal thing. Oh, this person wouldn't.
Yeah.
You know, so, but maybe
especially
he's thinking,
when you're excited because you're like, oh, I never thought I'd be friends with this
Louis,
person.
He likes what I did.
Oh,
but,
cool.
But then he's thinking, these two fucking girls like me? Like, they're going to come up to the room. We've been drinking. Again, I'm not hearing his side of it. I want to hear what he said and what he was thinking. I would love him to come out and go, look, yeah, I fucked up badly. I misread it. I really thought that they were on the same wavelength. And it's, you know, like, I would love to know that.
But I don't, there's no way that he could, in hindsight, honestly have thought that they were on the same wavelength, unless, like, in the moment
you could
have tricked himself into thinking that way.
Sure.
But but after, like, once it happens and they run out of the room and all, like, that's why you silence them.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? That's why your manager,
because you know afterwards that they didn't feel good about it. Yeah.
Yes.
I know what you're saying, Avery.
No, but I mean, women have, I guess some of it bothers me because it makes them such, and they are a victim, but such victims to everything. I mean, I feel like in corporate America where I work, there are many situations and you just kind of have to assess it and say, you know what? I'm going to assert myself and walk away. And yeah, it could come back to where I don't get that promotion or I don't get to be this or that. But you know what? I've made the right decision. And if I'm sitting there and a guy gets naked, I'm leaving. And I don't care how important he is. That's creepy.
Yeah, I mean, look, some people are made up a little bit differently and more comfortable walking out of that situation. You know, for me, on the phone is one thing, though. On the phone, you can always get off the phone. I won't say that the phone is the same. In the room or when the person is looking at you and you're in the presence of a person who you admire, it is a little bit scarier. Yeah. And if they're higher up on the ladder than you, I don't think it's for career advancement. I don't think it's, hey, I'll let him jerk off and I'll go places so you're selling yourself out. I think it's, I'm uncomfortable and I'm scared that there's going to be a repercussion. Yeah, I think that does happen.
And you go, and there's a little bit of like, oh, I thought I was going to now be friends with this guy.
But I also don't think that Louis should be thrown in the same fucking boat. If this is all there is, he should not be put in the same boat with fucking Harvey Weinstein and Kevin Spacey and other guys out there who they're saying are touching underage people.
Yeah.
Or fucking, you know, I mean, it's like, let's be, you know, real honest. The fucking allegations are piling up against Roman Polanski. There's one girl, woman saying that he fucked around with her when she was 10. There's a lot worse shit happening in Hollywood than my dumb friend not knowing that he shouldn't pull his stupid dick out. All right, thank you, Avery.
Just one last thing. If you decide to stay because you admire this person or you have some reason, whether it's furthering your career, whether you like this person, admire this person, whatever it is, if you decide on your own accord to stay, Avery. And how can you call him out later?
What if you're in shock and you're scared?
There are times. I'm talking more about the work. To me, the one that's a problem is at work. Like at work, again, with someone who's not necessarily your equal in position at work. Like if it's two writers, all right, that's shitty judgment. But if one's like, yeah, I'd love to watch you jerk off, and you're in the office doing it, like it's stupid to do it at work. That's a different dynamic than one person is higher than the other. It's the work stuff to me.
That's a big thing.
Yeah, because I don't know the comedy team, so I don't know what they're like as people. I don't think I've ever spoken to them, so I can't say like I know them as people either.
I just don't understand.
Thank you, Avery.
Appreciate the call. The one thing that all these stories for me have in common is I can't understand how many of these dudes, and it's all guys, like maybe because you just don't hear about women, unless it's like, I guess, teachers with students. You don't hear about women abusing their power like this. Like maybe it's just not, maybe just genetically, it doesn't happen.
You hear about it less, much, much less. Occasionally, yeah. But much less, yeah.
But like, these guys that just can't control their dicks, that just go crazy and do things that like, as a person, you just kind of don't do. I guess I've just never been in that manic of a place.
See, and now, and then this is something I've kind of, it's every woman has dealt with stuff, and every man has creeped women out. We all have at times, maybe not on a certain level.
Not the Teff dog.
Apparently he creeped out one woman.
You talking about his mom?
Yep. But you know, we all have at times creeped women out. We all have. And
do you think even I've creeped out women?
I think the fact that you fell out of a vagina creeps out a woman, like the potential for this exists. Like, oh my God, sex could lead to. But you know, every man, and there's guys out there who are like, I've never creeped. Yes, you have.
Yeah.
You know, most of us don't do it to a Harvey Weinstein level. But we've all thought that someone was enjoying something they weren't. And again, it doesn't have to be sex. It could just be a text message, or it could just be something you're saying to somebody. And there is a place where a woman has to tell you, like, well, I'm not enjoying this. You do have to say that sometimes, because we don't always know the rules either.
Yeah, that hasn't happened to every... Not every man finds himself in it. Everybody creeps out somebody at some point, but not every man finds himself in a situation where a woman has to be like, whoa, I'm not into that, slow down.
No, but sometimes like, you've been kissing with somebody, or you're kissing a girl, you're out on a date, and you think she likes you, and then all of a sudden she ghosts you. I've had that. You go out with somebody, you think...
Definitely.
It wasn't a creepy sexual thing, but I thought she liked me.
You misread.
Totally misread. Yes. I've misread many times like that. Like, I'm like, oh, this is going pretty good. But I'll see, and all of a sudden, I just don't hear from him. I'm like, all right. She didn't like my dirty text messaging. Yeah. I thought she did. Oh, well.
Yeah, but you really send a lot of those dirty texts, don't you?
I do. Yeah, that's like my fucking downfall.
You like them.
Yep. To me, it doesn't exist. It's not real. It's not, it's just something it's in your head.
How careful are you with who you send texts to, or how carefully you send them? Like, do you think, if you're looking at it from a sober point of view right now, you're not charged up right
now.
Sure. Have there been times where you're like, in hindsight, yeah, I shouldn't have sent that text?
Yeah, but it's usually I'll send it. It's never like the overt one is never first. Usually you work your way into it,
mm-hmm.
because that's part of what I like about it. Like, I like somebody's, it's not that I like consent because I'm a great guy. It's just I like that dirty part of another person, mm-hmm. it doesn't turn me on somebody who's not feeling it.
Right.
And again, there's nothing to do with me being moralist. It's just, it doesn't excite me.
It's probably an ego thing and a fear of rejection. Like, I couldn't handle it. If I even get a hint that somebody is not into what's going on, I'm like, okay, I'm done.
Yeah.
I'm done.
Yeah, it's just, it's not a sexy thing for me. What I like is somebody's dark secrets. Like, if somebody has them, like the things that women are embarrassed about, like, yeah. I've always said that, like, if you've taken 5 dicks at one time and you're ashamed, you could never tell your, please tell me. I will hug you and I'll fucking kiss you.
I'll kiss that precious mouth.
But you know what I mean? Like, that is what turns me on, somebody's dirtiness.
Yeah.
Not somebody feeling like, whoa.
Right.
That's just never been my thing.
I get that.
Courtney in Virginia, yes.
Hi. Hello? How are you?
Hi.
Hi. So I'm in the medical device industry and I'm in my 20s. And this is something that you kind of just know going into like a situation like that. Like, there's going to be really creepy surgeons that I've had to deal with. And you kind of just, I don't know, you have to have a kind of a mindset going in that like things can go a little south when you do dinners and there's alcohol involved. And you just kind of have to set boundaries ahead of time. So I have a hard time hearing these stories and they're 10 years later and all of a sudden.
Wouldn't Courtney?
You know, they have a big problem.
Would it not be a good thing if, because of all this going on, you got to a place where you didn't just have to accept that surgeons were going to be creepy to you, like that all these people are getting called out, and it made it so that surgeons could not just be creepy, and you as a woman just have to realize, well, that's just the way things are. People are going to be creepy, and if I'm going to go to dinner with somebody, I have to assume that I may be there may be some sexual misconduct. Like, wouldn't it be nicer if that wasn't the case?
It would be super nice, but it's kind of something you deal with if you're like a relatively attractive person and any.
Excuse me, I had no idea.
If you're, you know, if you're out and there's alcohol flowing and you're just having a good time.
You mean bottles popping?
Yeah, bottles popping. If there's any sort of, you know, like comfortable vibe at all, then you're gonna have to deal with people taking things and taking vibes like a different way than you mean for them to. And so that's when you have to kind of take responsibility for yourself and just know, you know, I've had definitely situations where like I've had surgeons like full on try to make out with me and things nice. Like that. And you just have to set the standard of like, this is not going to happen. And then if it goes too far, which it's definitely gone like way too far where I definitely could have done something about it, but I just say, look, I'm not covering your surgeries anymore. Like, this is what's going on. You involve HR if you need to. And it's unfortunate, but I just think that it's...
Well, this is HR for Hollywood. Like, there's no HR in Hollywood. So all you can do if you want to involve HR in Hollywood is tell the New York Times what happened.
Well, yeah, because if the problem becomes if you tell somebody, hey, I'm not comfortable with this, and like the one girl that said that he asked her on the set, and again, he asked her, he didn't grab her. It's a shitty place to ask somebody, but again, he did ask for consent. It wasn't like he was like, fucking watch this bitch. But then she's like, no, and he goes, okay, and that's it. And then she does. She went and she told them, and I guess he apologized to her X amount of time.
Sorry.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I don't know. Like,
what more? I just don't understand, like, what some of these women that did get apologies and things like that, it doesn't make it right, but then it's like, what do you want now?
Well, I think the Times kind of comes to them and is saying, like, did this happen? They're just kind of telling what happened. I don't know necessarily. It's not like they're blogging about it a year later. They're just, you know, a reporter calls you and asks you, and you're like, all right, well, if this is the story now, yeah, I'll talk about it. You know?
Yeah.
All right, thank you very much, Courtney.
I guess, thank you.
All right, take care. Yeah, women, look, it's interesting to hear women say, yes, Caroline in New York. Hello, Caroline.
Hey, Jimmy, how are you?
I'm good, how are you?
Hey, man.
Good,
I mean, lady.
Good. I've actually been through this situation, something similar, but just before I start that, to let you know, on the CBS News this morning, they had the reporter that broke the Louis story. And she said that Louis is going to come out with a statement later today.
Okay, yeah, I hope so. I mean, and it's like, it's really weird when it's somebody that you are so close to and that you care about, because you do care. And again, it's hard with something like this too, because you're like, well, how did they interact with each other? There's a little bit of vagueness here, even though the work shit's very inappropriate. Like, you know, if you're friends with a guy who's accused of pedophilia. Or accused of fucking rape.
Very different.
It's a much different energy. It's much easier to separate yourself. But I personally, if this is the way it is, I kind of wish he had spoken about this a long time ago and just said, look, this is what it is. It's a fucking, but whatever. What else, Caroline? Sorry.
I was just going to say that I wish people had more understanding as to how it's career suicide if you come out especially in the corporate world, if you come out and accuse someone of sexual harassment, I mean, I went through it myself. If you come out and accuse someone who has more power, who brings money into the organization, it is absolute career suicide. And to hear a woman say, one of your last callers say, well, if you don't like it, just leave. I mean, I've worked 15 years to build my career, so some asshole could say something horrible to me. And HR works for the company. So when people say go to HR, it's the last thing to do.
Well, you know what, Caroline? I'm going to say this. In the last X amount of years, I don't know if that's as true, because I think the last, and again, we're talking about in the last, not forever, because what's happened is lawsuits with major companies have cost companies $15 million and $10 million and $30 million. If it's proven the company had a prior knowledge of sexual harassment and allowed it to continue or was complicit in any way, that's why, especially when you get something like Kevin Spacey, they're like, no more house cards. Because technically Netflix doesn't shoot that. The production company does.
Right.
So once it comes out, that now they have knowledge. Oh, forget it, no more. Because God forbid one more thing happens when they had prior knowledge, you're finished. So I don't know if that's as true now.
But I agree, Jim. But the only problem is in most situations, the individual is fired, but you're painted with a scarlet letter.
Yeah.
So people stay away from you. And that's part that's career suicide.
Yeah, it's almost like if Caroline gets sexually harassed, right, and she goes to HR about it, then now all the dudes in the office are like, oh, we can't say hi to Caroline because she's going to accuse us of sexual harassment when probably what you accused this person of was legitimate. I mean, with this whole conversation, I don't understand why people want to skew this and say, well, why don't we just teach women to say no? Why don't we just teach women to walk out of the hotel room when we finally have this option to instead teach everybody that the behavior is bad and that we should be shaming men who do this as opposed to women who don't walk out of a room?
I'll tell you why there's both of those things. It's because, again, the younger generation with this is smarter than we are. Because they had a different set of rules when they were raised. But I'm 50, Louis 50. Not that it excuses behavior. But when you're coming up, you're taught that a lot of times it's a dance you're doing. You're taught that seduction is a dance. You're taught that, hey, this is how we interact. A lot of times she'll say no because she's supposed to say no, but you got to finesse it, and then she'll say it. Like, you know, and you talk to your grandparents about how they met. How many times have you heard older people say, oh, I didn't like him at all. I hated him. And he wouldn't stop. He just wouldn't stop. Like, look at The Notebook. Consider this romantic film. And meanwhile, I hated that because this fucking cock blocker is hanging on the Ferris wheel while she's on a date with another guy. She's already told him no. And this guy's like, come on, go out with me. And she's like, oh, he's such a bad boy.
Uh-huh.
Like, you get these messages and you're taught that being the bad boy or hearing no. You know, again, I'm not talking about rape. I'm talking about this dance we do when you're becoming sexual, when you're interacting. A lot of times it's very easy to step back and go, hey, she didn't want it and you should have known that. But a lot of times, there's been plenty of times where it's like a woman is like, yeah, she kind of did want it, but she didn't know how to say yes. She didn't want to feel like a slut. There's a weird dance you do where everybody is kind of not just saying, hey, I want to do this. And she's going, well, I don't. And then there are times where you literally don't know if someone is not interested or if it's a part of this weird communication that we have.
But every time that it becomes a problem, it's never a matter of the dance. It's a matter of the guy becomes aggressive and makes it happen.
But in this case, is that what it is? Where do they become aggressive? Right. And I'm not defending because my friend. I'm saying I don't know what the answer is.
If you follow the timeline that's in this thing, it doesn't sound like there's any time to have the dance. Like, he just is like, okay, now it's time to masturbate.
I don't know about that. If you're downstairs and you're drinking with them, and maybe you're right. That very well may have been what happened. But if they're downstairs and they're drinking together, and he goes, hey, do you want to come up? And he thinks he's getting an energy that he's not getting. And they think they're getting a professional energy that they're not getting. He's like, well, they must know what I want. I mean, come on. They're two hot girls and I'm the guy.
Who doesn't want to sit there and just watch me masturbate?
I don't quite understand that either. But, I mean, it's not crazy. You can't pretend that men and women don't have these weird interactions. You can't pretend that men don't misread a lot of times
signals.
No, but signals.
It is crazy to misread from, we don't even, like, we're not here to hook up, to I'm naked and masturbating. Like, you don't get that far off.
But if that's your turn on and that's what you're geared towards, and you think that that's what they... I don't understand how... Because, again, that's not how my mind works.
You can't cross signals to that degree. If they didn't want anything sexual and he's naked and masturbating, it's like, There's no way you can misread
didn't
that.
Didn't he joke about it and they thought he was kidding? Maybe he didn't think that they thought he was kidding. And maybe they said that they were laughing and screaming. Again, obviously uncomfortable. But if you're in his headset and you think that this is what they like, or you think that they're getting off, or part, you know, this sounds crazy. There are men who have fetishes for being laughed at. There are guys that have weird small dick fetishes for being laughed at. There's guys who get off on being laughed at and humiliated. So maybe he thinks that they're into the humiliation. I don't know. It's not my turn on. But it's not crazy to think that sometimes you have to go like, well, I'm not enjoying this. And like you said, at times it makes somebody go, oh, okay, I literally thought you were. Because for me, it's being an exhibitionist and feeling humiliated about it.
I guess, but it's up to the exhibitionist who's got this kink that most people don't have to understand that most people are going to be like, what the fuck is going on right now that it's not normalized
to
other people?
You might think that consent, again, the idea that somebody would say, do you want to watch me jerk off? Like, the fact that somebody would put it that way. do you understand what I mean? There's a different mentality there.
Right.
There's a different thought behind
but
that.
But don't you think it's Louis's responsibility to understand that his mentality is not matched by other people? So his, just because it's not inappropriate to him, does not mean that it's not inappropriate?
Of course. So he may think that it's he may know it's inappropriate, and by saying, hey, do you want to watch me? To him, maybe that's making it okay. Oh, she said no. Okay. Like, for him, if they don't say no, they're saying, like, you know, hey, do you want to do this? Like, I never, for me, the seduction is kind of fun. Like, I could never ask anybody, do you want to watch me jerk off? And again, it's just not my turn on.
Yeah.
But if your, like, thing is, like, I like to do this, do you want to watch me? And how many women probably went, no, I don't. And he went, oh, okay. Like, I don't.
It's such a crazy.
But do you understand, like, that it's just not my mindset?
Yeah.
But to say that signals don't get crossed, like, if you're.
Just not, I just can't say.
Thank you, Caroline. It's one of those things where I can't wrap my head around any of it because it's not my mentality. It's not something that gets me off. I don't understand the turn on of it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, even if she says, yes, I want to watch you jerk off, well, then
it's like, why?
Yeah.
Why? What do you want to do that for?
That would have to happen. Like, I like it, you know, alone, play with my nipples. Fucking.
You like nipple play?
I do.
Travis, do you like nipple play?
No.
Troy?
I do not at all.
Okay, so it's just you, Jim, with the nipple stuff?
It's not even like on a list of things that I would like even consider.
I do like it.
Who's in there with you, Travis?
Baby Nico? Shitloaf.
No baby Nico?
Nico's getting the food.
Now, Matt in Philly said Sam is on fire. Hey, what's up, Matt? How are you?
Yeah, he is.
Very well. Good to call into the show. I listen to you guys all the time. You're always very smart. Today, Sam is right on the money. No matter what people call up with or what the comment is, don't skew it one degree. Just let it be lousy and let it go away. The more attention that this gets, the more people in the next day, year, or 10 years might not do anything weird like this.
What do you mean don't give it the attention? It's a New York Times story.
I think he means don't justify it.
Let everybody come out. Let everybody tell their story, no matter if it's 10 years old or 10 days ago. I'm just saying it deserves to be said if it happened to you.
But you know what?
Were harassed or a guy got naked or took his dick out, any of that. I don't mind what you do sexually. I'm just saying in regular environments or work environments.
But you don't think that it has to be, people are just talking about it. No one is saying don't come out and talk about it. We're just discussing it.
I think because there's many
people. People are calling and saying, hey, that was 10 years ago.
Oh, yeah. 10 years ago doesn't necessarily matter. But
not you guys. You guys, great. Keep talking about it. I just think ever since this came out, I'm 42 years old. And get this ball rolling, because I've been bothered by guys, girls, in public, at the job. And if it's happening to me, it's surely happening to hundreds of thousands and millions of people. So they got to get a light on this, and they got to stomp it
out. Well, by the way, who is the guy, the Republican under pressure?
Oh, my God.
Roy Moore has been accused. Thank you very much, Matt. It's unfortunate that the Louis story is almost bigger than this, and it's like just because he's a comedian or entertainer. This Roy Moore is being, what's he being nominated for? Senator?
He's on the ballot.
They're alleging that he fucked a girl, or sexual, not fucked, but did something sexual. She's alleging when she was 14 and he was 32.
Yeah, it's strict pedophilia. That's 100%.
And they said he groomed her because her mother was there for jury duty or something. And he's like, I'll sit out here. You don't want to see what's going on in there. And
he was a judge at the time.
Oh, he was a judge, right. And he's like, I'll sit outside.
Mm-hmm.
He was a prosecutor. I think he was
a
prosecutor.
And then he was a judge.
And then they're sitting outside and he's like, I'll watch her. And as a woman, if you go to court, you're thinking like, all right, this is a prosecutor. And this fucking,
especially back then, like in the 70s or whatever.
79. Yeah.
I just think that, like, all these stories should come out, and the more conversation that we have associated with these stories about how people should have said no or not gone to a hotel room or not complained about it or, oh, you just regret it now. Like, all of those conversations just lead to people not coming forward. And I think that the conversations at this point in time should be about people being creeps and that people shouldn't be creeps.
Yes, but you should also make sure that the people accused of being creeps, A, knew they were being creeps and legitimately are guilty of it. Like, you want to make sure that people...
Knowing that you're being a creep, like, I don't think that it's an excuse to say, like, oh, I didn't know I was being a creep. Well, you should have. Like, I think being guilty of it, yes.
It does make a difference. Again, I'm not talking about Harvey Weinstein shit, but with interactions like this, it does make a difference if you know that you're being a creep. Because if you think somebody is enjoying it, if you think, like, hey, I don't understand how you could think two women want to watch you jack off, but if you do, if you think that you got consent by going, hey, I'm going to pull my dick out, and like, all right, like, or whatever they said, or you're being goofy because they're uncomfortable and nervous,
yeah,
and you don't know they're uncomfortable and nervous, you guys have been drinking together, and all of a sudden you think, like, yeah, they're going to fucking, they want to watch me jerk off, they're going to humiliate, whatever the fucking, I don't know.
I just think that, like, I love Louis, and you know, I'm sure that in his statement he will take ownership of it if it's true, and I think it probably is true.
I don't think any of them are lying. It doesn't sound like lies.
And I think he'll take ownership, but I think that when this is the stuff that gets you off, I think, like, Jim, you're into some weird stuff, right? And I think it's...
I'm into being the victim.
But I think it's your guys' responsibility, if you're into weird stuff, if I'm into weird stuff, it's our responsibility to understand how consent works to people whose brains don't work like ours, and it's not an excuse to say, well, this is normal to me, so I didn't know they didn't like it.
But they have to let you know they don't like it, too. It's as an adult...
Well, you have to know that in the workplace, just asking the question is bad.
Work is a bad place
right.
to do it.
Right.
Work is a bad place to do it. And because not only is it, like, it's uncomfortable because you have to see the person, but it's like... You have to think just selfishly. It's like you can ruin your career by being... You know, if you're at HBO, you just can't do that.
Right.
I don't fucking flirt with anybody.
Right.
You know,
except somebody sitting across the table from
it's
you.
It's not even flirting. You've given me mouth consent. we have a guest coming in just a minute. The reason we're stalling a little bit because we have to break and we have food coming up. So we're going to get Dave Rubin in here shortly from the Rubin Report.
He's a great dude. He worked here a while ago and he ventured out to do stuff independently. He's got an amazing YouTube channel. I mean, he was interviewing all these guys, Milo Yiannopoulos and Ben Shapiro and, like, all the kind of big news-making
people. Is Dave a conservative guy?
He is... No, he's a moderate guy. But he's just a really interesting dude. He's a gay dude.
Sure.
And, you know, he kind of has had to deal with a lot from both sides because he's one of the few people that have been able to make a real living and make an impact as... somebody who's, like, a truly moderate guy. He's not an extreme guy on one end or the other. He likes talking to people and allows people to have opinions that are disagreeable, which I always like.
Yeah. I mean, there are times where people are like, how come you're not calling out so-and-so? It's like, oh, they're just kind of saying what they want to say.
I mean, just let him, and you're free to, you know, we let this person talk, and if it's ugly, you're free to be like, that guy's an asshole.
Yeah. Will in New York. Hello, Will.
Hey, guys.
Hey, buddy.
How's it going?
Good. How are you?
Just quickly, I just wanted to say it's so weird that, Sammy, you were just saying that about being free to say what you wanted to say. Because when I was being screened by Shitloaf, he jumped the gun again and assumed he knew what I was going to say. So he jumped in and said, yeah, I don't want to talk about that. And
he didn't want to talk about?
Well, he didn't want to talk. I was going to bring up how those girls were saying how he was being creepy and, you know, the infamous message, you know, I just want to fuck. And, like, when you guys had Lisa Ann on the other day, and she was saying, like, oh, my God, like, it's so creepy, and how could that not have been brought to HR and stuff?
He didn't want you to bring up his...
Are we screening phone calls based on what?
Wait, whoa, whoa, whoa. Is that true? Hold on a second.
Shitloaf didn't want his shit brought up.
Man, he tried to use his power over me.
Will, we will thank you, but we have to go because we're gonna take a break. I appreciate you waiting on hold, and I appreciate the call. Right. So now, is that true? Before we take a break, is that true? Where's Shitloaf?
He's falling over.
The only thing, he was like, I just want to bring up, you know, what you're talking, when you were creepy with the girls, you know, what they were saying. I was like, dude, we don't have to bring that up. We're talking about, you know, Louis C.K.
But wait a minute, hold on. You put people through who want to tell me I suck. You'll put people through who say Sam sucks.
Look, there's an online,
Troy's being a faggot. Like, all these weird
online
things.
Online 8, there's a guy that says, just wants to challenge Let Him In Sammy. Just a guy who wants to challenge me.
We don't want
to
talk about that.
Yeah, so how come all of our stuff, and we've seen ugly things come through. They want to yell at us or tell us we stink. How come with your stuff you didn't want to put it through?
I mean, I don't know.
Were you acting in the show's best interest or in Anthony's best interest? Where are you going?
So close. Where are you going? You walk away from the microphone.
It's Friday. So close.
Why are you not letting calls through about you?
I didn't let...
Just be honest.
I didn't let calls through. I just don't want to talk about my situation that happened here with all this shit going on.
So you're making that decision as the phone screener.
But, first of all, that guy was going to say what he was going to say regardless of what I said.
Because that guy hates me. But if you don't put what he's saying on the phone screen, we don't have the option to go to
it. I put what he said on the phone screen. That's the first thing he said was what I put on the phone screen. And I also want to talk about what you said about with the girl.
You have a bit today, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so what if I say to my head, in my producer's mind, if I hope you say,
here comes a bullet.
If I go, okay, I want to play Anthony's bit today. How do I get the conversation to be about Anthony? Oh, there's a caller that wants to throw Anthony under the bus for the messages. I can get that caller, and then I can lead into the bit. Jim, you see where that would work, right? You would probably think it's similar thing.
I certainly do. But yeah, Anthony, you can't, because we've all, you know, we don't have to go to the call, but if somebody calls up, and again, you know, unless it's something we've said we don't want to, you still have to put it up. Troy, comment?
No comment.
Troy doesn't make comments about Anthony anymore.
Okay.
Anthony,
he just walked away from the mic.
Any opinion on that, or are we way off?
No, you guys are right. I apologize. It won't happen again.
Why do you always say that? It always happens again. I've never seen anybody say it won't happen again more times. I've never heard that phrase more times. That you have two t-shirts that should come out. One should say, I just want to fuck. And the other should say, I'm very sorry, it won't happen again.
And a shitloaf hat.
Matter of fact, Travis, can you get me a drop of Anthony saying, I'm very sorry, it won't happen again? I would like it for my soundboard, please.
Of course, as long as it's okay with Anthony.
We can make an arrangement.
Okay, thank you for your permission, Anthony.
All right, let's take a quick break. Yes. Dave Rubin will be in here.
Yes.
And I got Town Hall tomorrow night, 9:45. I'm really looking forward to this gig a lot. And, you know, call up, we'll talk to Dave Rubin. We got Joe Coy coming in, and we'll talk about whatever you want.
More Jim Norton and Sam Roberts after this.